All right, so we are running this presentation over the internet to this computer and then up to there. So there's actually a several second delay. That's going to kind of mess up a couple things, but it'll be all right. We'll make do. If you don't know me, I'm a lead developer at LockerGnome. I run the architecture as well. Been programming for a long freaking time. My dad started teaching me when I was six, so I've made a lot of mistakes over the years, and I think that's probably why I know how to do a few things. That's about all I got. And then ask questions during this talk. That's really important. This is really hard stuff, so please interrupt me and ask questions, because I will otherwise completely lose all of you. Little background about LockerGnome, so you know, I'm sure about half you know it, but we have about 20 million monthly unique visitors, which is not a small number. We've been written up in Wall Street Journal, Forbes, MarketWatch, and we work with basically all the best. And we're more like social graph, like Pinterest or Meetup or any of those, rather than, you know, Facebook or Google Plus, which is more focused on, you know, social graph. So the interest graph is really more about like what you're interested in. Since we're all here, it's kind of obvious, like we're interested in technology, that's why we're here. Rather than Facebook, if I want to go on Facebook, I see like, hey, someone's about to have a baby. Like, I mean, no offense, but I don't really care, you know? Like, I'm much more interested in what, you know, Brad has to say about technology, because he's a smart guy, and, you know, that's where we connect. So that's interest graph versus social graph. So you kind of think of it like, you have interest-based feed. It's like if you go to Reddit or any of those, you know, it's that same kind of concept. And then the other thing that we're really big on here at LockerGnome is unifying conversations. So if you post something, wow, this is really hard to read. If you post something on LockerGnome and 10 other people post that same article, we group that conversation together so that you can find other people who are talking about the same thing, which I think is pretty cool. All right, so first things, I'm gonna give a little demo to kind of show you why we make everything more complicated. So if you wanna go to this bit.ly address, it's not gonna be super real time because my computer is delayed, but I'll show you. So this is, make sure you guys can see this. I think this is a funny GIF, frankly. Coder factory, and you're like, woo, I'm gonna do it. I'm gonna fall in, you know, so. Oh, you can't see it very well. So pull it up on your phone, but basically a cat falls in, thinks that he's going to be good to go, not so much. And what's cool about LockerGnome is that we do real-time updating of everything. So if one of you comments right now or likes something right now, then I think it's about a 4-second delay from my computer to here. The delay from your phone to updating on my screen is like well under a second. So it's going to be real-time updated, so if anybody goes to that URL, anybody? No? Oh, there we go. Good old perfect swarm. It'll show up in a few seconds here. It just showed up on my computer. And then if I like it, which okay, it's pretty quick on my screen. Anybody who's watching on their computer will see it update immediately. So this is kind of why we do what we do. So, we'll talk a little bit about the technology involved to make this happen. So when you have 20 million users, it becomes a little bit more complicated to make sure that everything on the page gets updated in real time. We have multiple data centers, and then each data center has a whole array of sharded out node instances, and then each of those, in turn, has multiple clients. I make this look like we only have 12 concurrent users, but in fact, I assure you we have quite a bit more than that, as you may have guessed. So this is actually a very difficult problem because you have essentially multiple levels of cache hierarchy, and you need to keep them all in sync, and you're not just pulling information, you're actually pushing information down to each of them in real time. So that's kind of the problem that drove us to make everything a lot more complicated. Does everybody understand that so far?
Cool.
All right, So to kind of, all right, so to give you some kind of perspective on this, can't see any of these numbers, but this is a vote count up here. It's 35,000. So you know, anytime one person votes, that number updates immediately. And when I say immediately, I mean like it's probably on most connections, probably under 100 milliseconds for it to update. Anybody in the world, you know, votes on that, it's like pretty much immediate. So to make that happen, and these are percentage totals, which unfortunately, because of the way we're running, you can't see it. These could potentially change. This is a total of vote counts for each person on this poll. Those will change all in real time. And basically, this is just a small snapshot of what was a much bigger screen. Any of those things could change at any time. So that's what we have to deal with.
And that's all push?
It's all push, so we're using WebSockets, which I'll talk a little bit more about. All right, so in order to accomplish that, we use the functional reactive pattern. For those of you who aren't familiar, basically what happens is some kind of action, in this case like a user votes, and they're like, hey, who did they vote for? Oh, they voted for Amir, or they voted for Amir, or they voted for Marcos. So then we update various things. This is, says total votes and percentages for each of these. So then we update those things on the screen. So this is just one client, and this is actually only just a very small sample of the things you have on the screen. In practice, we actually have more like probably 10,000 observables or something in memory. So it's a little bit more complicated. Are people generally familiar with this pattern? Maybe you've used Angular or Ember or any of those? We'll dig a little bit deeper, but basically what you can think of is, at any given time, there is a value for total votes. There is a number of votes for Marcos. There is a number of votes for Amir. All these have values. And then as things update, we push down and update each thing that depends on that. And we keep all those completely up to date, and then we push that out and update whatever's on our user interface accordingly. These inputs come in from, yeah. Oh.
So most of these variables are dependent on the votes for X and votes for Y?
Yes.
Are all the dependent ones tracked on the server side or just the client side?
So let's keep it high level here. We'll talk through that because there's some trade-offs there. So yeah, but this is the problem we're dealing with. This is actually across a bunch of tiers. Let's simplify it for purposes of high level. Good question. So once these all have kind of flushed their way out and updated everything there, then we're like, hey, cool, we're up to date. So there's a small lag involved in doing that.
Is the graph always acyclic, or?
Yes, it is. If you had a cyclic graph, you'd have all sorts of problems.
Do you explicitly disallow?
Yeah. And actually, because we do more of a kind of a declarative style, it's not even really, like we can detect it, compile time, as we call it, if there were going to be a cycle.
Is that a DAG by any chance? DAG is a graph or just a graph?
It's a DAG.
It's a directly graph.
Yeah. Alright, so this is probably not going to show really well. I'm guessing. Oh, cool. Well, hopefully you guys can see this. So this is an example. This isn't exactly what we use, but it's, it'll give you kind of a high level. So if you were to think about it, this is your view code, and then this will be, I'll talk through in a second. So with your view, you'd want to say, okay, I want to put the total votes here on my UI. I want to put the name of the first choice, and then maybe I have a special class that's either set or not set, depending on some kind of condition, like is this first choice winning or not? Maybe I want to color it differently. Maybe I want to put a star in front of it, whatever it is. These are going to be things that need to get updated, though. So on the initial draw, you want to define it this way for obvious reasons. And then if you were using something like jQuery, you'd probably just blow your brains out because you'd have to update all this in real time. But with something that's like more powerful, like Angular or Ember or like our system that I'm talking about, it would actually do that for you because it would. If you look at the previous slide, this first choice here would, the vote counts, these are mapping to these individual things here. So when anything happens server side that changes it, it's smart enough to know what to update for you because, there we go, because it has placeholders for these. So when it compiles this template, it's smart enough to hook up all the event handlers for you to make sure that you don't have to deal with that, because that's error prone and it's buggy software. And frankly, if you're writing jQuery, you do this kind of stuff, and it's not a joke, you should fire yourself, because it's completely unmaintainable for any size project. So anyway, there's a lot of different ways of representing that syntax, but this is just kind of one example. This is similar to some others that are out there. It's similar to what we do. You define the name of whatever you want to call it, like in this case, the total votes, and then you'd say, hey, what's it dependent on? It's dependent on the first choice count, the second choice count, and you just add them together to get that value. Yeah.
Is what goes in the curly braces up there at the top always the name of a property and not a more complicated expression?
Yeah, so I mean, this is really more of an example. There are a lot of different syntaxes different people use. You can certainly put expressions in here, and it really depends on the framework you're working with. So there's some people would say you shouldn't put any logic in there, and some people would say, oh, you should put expressions in there. I think ultimately how a framework works and how you use it is, you know, there's trade-offs and all that stuff. But yeah, that's a common pattern to put basic expressions. I think a lot of times things like capitalizing, they call it filter functions, are really good to have in there.
Is that bottom piece of code, is that setting up the relationships between the data elements?
That's exactly right. Okay. Yeah. So if we go back to here, back to the previous slide, we'll see how these various functions, right? So this total votes depends on these two things. So it has a function which says, hey, I depend on this, and you get my value by adding them together. And so it sets up those relationships. And then on the initial draw or in subsequent updates, it knows exactly how to do that. You only code that once, which is much better. The jQuery approach, I'm sure most people have written, is, oh, I just liked something, I need to increase the like count. I'll pull out the like thing and convert it to an integer and add one to it and then like write it back. Yeah. Well, that's pretty hacky. Most people have probably written code like that. So this would be an example of not using the filters where we actually would do some level of converting this into percentage and that sort of thing. But you could move that in a few and everyone has their opinion on that. So if people kind of understand how this works, yeah, good. Alright, so this I'm going to kind of now focus some more kind of on like an individual client. So if you think about it, back to our original picture, we have multiple data centers, each one has multiple instances, and then each of these has multiple clients attached to it. Now for an individual client, gosh, this is so fuzzy. This is the initial data for the page would come in on a page load, and then it populates your observable tree, which is that spiderwebby looking thing, and then that hooks up to your actual interface. If you click on the interface, then there's an event handler function, which will push off to the backend, do whatever it needs to do, and then the backend will return information and say, hey, you need to update these things. If somebody else clicks, votes on something, the same thing will happen. So this is our basic front-end architecture that we've got. And it does basically all those things. Finds all properties that can change on the DOM, handles propagation of changes, and it serves as a local cache. So if you've already fetched information, you don't fetch it again, and it passes the events back. Yes.
Is there a runtime scheduler in the front end, or I should say, in the front end runtime? Mm-hmm. Do you have the scheduler there, resident, controlling everything, or do you compile that away as part of the compile process, so it just ends up being a bunch of changes?
Right. So you generally want to have some form of scheduling taking place, and you do need to have a centralized control for that. If you do not, then you end up having a ton of reflows. So what will happen is, say for instance, you change this one thing, and you know 20 other things all change at the same time. Well, now you have like a bunch of update cycles, and if one of those things that in turn has to go fetch some data from the back end, then it'll be another round trip to fetch that, and then it'll cause more updates. And you can end up with this whole flurry of updates on your page, and if they're not all in the same tick, then the way the browser will work is it will have to recompute the way the page looks a bunch of times. So it's good to schedule them somehow, but there's lots of trade-offs there too, because you don't want to necessarily not show the information when it comes in. And yeah, that's complicated.
Related question,
yes.
When you're traversing the dependency graph, are there asynchronous boundaries between nodes, or do you use the synchrony hypothesis so that when you're traversing the graph, it's guaranteed to be synchronous?
So We're right now actually about to push out a change to how we're doing that, so it will fully resolve out. You probably don't ever end up doing it completely one way, like just in practice, because you end up with special cases with things that just like this one really should be done this way. But you want to pick a good default for your framework, and I think fully resolving is a good default. Especially if you have fast communication with the back end.
Sure.
So, put some code up here. This is not the prototype we use for observables, but I wanted to show you guys a basic implementation you could use for an observable. I mean, the point is, it's really, really simple pattern. Basically, what you have some kind of an object that handles a change event. You could use, if you're using Node, you could use event emitters. You can do the on pattern. In this case, just made a function called on change. The downside of this is that you just have one function and you could polymorphically overwrite it. You could certainly do it where you have a one-to-many kind of relationship and you can attach event handlers if you prefer. But it would be more code than this, so that's why I didn't do that. But this one is basically, hey, we have the compute function, which in this case would have references to observables it needs. You've set its initial value. You say, hey, I'm going to be able to have listeners. And you save the compute function so that when you have your on change, you can recompute yourself. And after you recompute yourself, you call your listeners and tell them, hey, you probably need to recompute yourself too. You'd want to do a lot of other things like stop the propagation if the value hasn't changed. And this is a very basic skeleton of how you might implement this. Does this make sense? I see about half the heads nod, which makes me think I'm actually doing better than I expected at this point. So if you have questions, really ask. Okay, so I'm going to go back to the earlier diagram. And I talked a little bit about this, but that same observable, we would have that on change. We would hook up those change handlers to these individual pieces right here. So that if this changes, this will update. This changes, this will update, this changes, this will update, and so on. And so basically, we would use a polymorphic pattern where we expect the thing that's listening downstream to have a change handler, or we hook it up and use the observer pattern. Either way you do it, it's the same basic relationship. So that's on this side, and on the other side, you have things that are pushing to these individual observables, and one thing what you do there is you set your value for some kind of a concept of, hey, this is something you do the back end, and then you say, call your listeners. So that's how you integrate on your side of the observables. Does that make sense? All right, so that was pretty easy. There's a billion frameworks that do that already. But as I said, we take that paradigm of functional reactive and extend it beyond just one computer. Like if you look at Ember or Angular, they handle this for one computer. But in our system, hey, someone votes, and now we have to traverse across data centers, across instances, all the way over to this client over here, or anybody else who happens to be looking at that pool, and update that in real time. So we're going to break this down, because if I try to cover all that in one pass, we'll probably lose all of it. So we'll start with a single server. This you can think of it like a basic Node app that just is like a chat server. It's pretty easy. Someone comments on something or can post something and bam, it's updating. So pretty much the basic pattern would be like, hey, I go to the poll. That updates the total votes. I probably write it off the database too. And then I have some kind of an index of what all the different clients are listening to. And I'm like, hey, who's listened to the total number of votes on such and such poll? Cool. These two people, let them know that's going on. So one server would be responsible for keeping track of the subscriptions for all of its connected clients. And then for those of you, yeah.
You probably get into this, but how does even the one server, do you guys like to do it? Do you use like an in-memory store like Redis?
Our database uses Redis. We actually use JavaScript variables. At some point when we need additional performance, we're probably going to switch that to a different type of in-memory cache, but Redis would not be a bad choice, but our latency is actually way lower because it's just fetching in local memory. So in the common case, your overhead is essentially about 100 nanoseconds, probably, if you have a cache miss. If you hit your L1 cache, it's more like 3 nanoseconds. You know, so it's just a lot faster than fetching something, even through like the local file system. It's going to be a lot slower because it's going to have to make system calls and that sort of thing. Which a lot of times comes out to about 100 microseconds. So,
is a locker dome page that you're looking at one long page, and so when you bring it up, everything that's on there is something you want to subscribe to, or can you switch to a different context and now the things you were looking at, you're not interested now because they're not on your current page, and so you want to unsubscribe and subscribe to new things?
Right. So it depends on what page you're looking at. Some pages you're subscribed to a smaller set of things than others, and right now the way we do it, you don't ever really forget a subscription unless that thing leaves the page. But clearly, if you were trying to go for optimal performance, you might say, hey, we've scrolled 5 screens down. We don't really care to update the poll counts on this thing up there. If we run into performance problems with it, or we have extra dev cycles, which will totally happen sometime, then we'll implement that optimization.
For sure.
Have your people here used WebSockets? How many? Raise your hand if you've used WebSockets. Okay. So I'll just give a little high level. WebSockets lets you basically act as though you have a socket connection between a client and your server. And you know, in theory, it should work well. In practice, there's a lot of things that can get in the way of those working well. So we use sock.js. There's a bunch of these libraries that will use long polling or some other mechanism if, for whatever reason, WebSockets aren't actually supported. WebSockets are part of HTTP, but not all browsers support them, some ISPs block them, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But you can treat it as basically a two-way stream connection.
You have a question?
Yeah.
What are the subscriptions, like a big subscriptions, used to keep them for a long time?
So when the page closes, then we would drop the subscriptions because the socket dies. So we clean up. And we actually store enough information on the client to rebuild all the subscriptions if needed. So the server can, in any time, just say screw you to the client if it's overworked or it crashes or whatever, and then it's up to the client to basically reconnect and say, hey, this is what I need to subscribe to. So that's how we can avoid things like denial of service or just, you know, reliability if you have to start a server or whatever it is. Cool. All right, so this is going to be a majorly simplified view of kind of what's going on. If you think about it, each of these are our little observables. I'm going to kind of walk you through this flow. So say I like something, that event goes off, and after validating that that's a valid action, whatever, it's going to update a bunch of observables. I'm just going to show one here. So then I update this observable. Now I have an in-memory tree of observables and their dependencies server side. And then when I get to a given one that updates, so say here, I say, oh, this one updates. Then I once again look at my cache and say, oh, there happens to be some client who's subscribing to this. So this will then travel over the WebSocket and update this, which then in turn will update whatever stuff is dependent on it as well. Similarly, it traverses through here. This one also updates, also gets sent over the WebSocket to that same client. And these would both be going through the same WebSocket connection. Other clients happen to be listening as well, just on that single server. So as it traverses through here, it's going to forward that along and forward that update along. So this is how we kind of distribute our observable tree across multiple computers. And this is a client. Does everybody kind of see that picture? Okay. All right, so I'm going to show you some real basic stripped down version of client-side code. If you inspected our code, you'd probably be able to find something like this, though not simplified like this. So this is basically the message handler you have in your client. So if you're familiar with WebSockets, it's basically just, hey, we just got a packet, so let's process that packet. So I don't need to walk through this too much. It's basically just protocol, really defined. But pretty much what it does is it reads a length, and then it says, okay, what's the name of the key that I'm updating, and then let's parse out the value, and then do some stuff, basically. And down here is the exciting part of, okay, I have our local cache of values that are represented server-side. Let's go ahead and update that observable locally. And then anything that's connected to that, it will forward along and do as we expect. So this is, on the client side, how we traverse that boundary of client to server. Does everybody follow that? Questions? It's a big, important step, so.
So in other words, if something was if an update came from the server and the client sets the value in the cache but it's the same, it's not going to trigger unnecessary updates or something like that?
So the client doesn't update its local cache ever. It always gets that information from the server.
Okay.
So, but if somebody, let's go back to the previous step.
I was just looking at that last line, local cache set value.
Yes, so that is right here. So value comes in to right here, and then this is the on message handler would be right in here somewhere, and it says, okay, I've just parsed that this observable now has this value. Let's update it, and then that's going to update this one and this one as well.
And it will stop propagation if it's not actually changed.
Right. Yeah. On our system, we have a number of optimizations, which are not in this code. But yeah, this last line is the one that sets the value locally. The thing that the client isn't actually setting the value, it's just syncing the value that it's getting from the server. All right,
that's going to kick off the chain reaction.
Exactly. So this is a simplified view of one data center. So basically, we do edit-based pushing all these. So instead of sending whole values across here, we actually have a transactional system, which I'll talk a little bit about in a bit. But that ensures that the packets are smaller, and also it means that if multiple things happen at the same time, you don't have to worry about syncing them up, because you might say, hey, this edit adds one, this edit adds one. If instead of setting it, my one might set it to 7, the other sets it to 7, and just lost a plus 1. So we won't get into too much, but anyway. So at the very top, you see we have our sharded array of databases. We actually have more of them, but it's a picture, simplified. So each of those gets the various edits written to it, and then we propagate the edits along in a packet from, this would be one server, to another server, so that both of them would get that update. And then, similarly, those do the same as before. They propagate to any of their connected clients. There's a bunch of these, just tons of them. So this would be for a single data center. In actual production, it's a lot more complicated. There's a lot more going on here. For reference, one of these typically has about 1,000 subscriptions. There's about 1,000 different things it's listening to. Yeah?
How do you do key subscription management? Like the graph in the cloud would be ridiculously large key-wise, so you don't have collisions. How do you do categorization of nodes, essentially?
So if I understand your question correctly, tell me if I don't answer it. We have like a system that at compile time, we look at the various entity types that we have, basically tables and the indexes, and we apply certain functions to say, okay, well, this prefix in our key space is going to correspond to this particular key or this particular index and this particular set of values for it. There's like our primary key, and that basically namespaces it and makes sure that there's not a collision on the actual key. And
so
then from that,
you
can deduce
the dynamic data.
What's that?
You're saying you compile the dynamic data, like vote for person X is a key.
Yes.
And that goes through a compilation?
We have schemas that we use at compile time, which I don't even want to get into all of it, but our whole system is strongly typed. So we look at it the same way a relational database works. We look at something and say, okay, it has these properties, so this is how we're going to do it. Our binary serialize. We actually binary serialize everything. It's much more memory efficient, more overall efficient. In our edits themselves, it looks at the metadata and creates a custom format automatically from the metadata to serialize all that and namespace all the keys and everything. So, it ensures that there's not going to be any collisions. Anything else there? Did that answer that?
Sort of. I mean, your local cache has a very well-defined key.
Okay. And the key that this uses is there's a one-to-one relationship between what these use, what these use, and what are used in there in the back end. We also have the observables themselves. Some of them are here and don't exist there if they're like computed intermediates and things like that. So like for instance, we have a computed intermediate that represents the order of feed items for a particular feed. Well, that one is based on various computations that look at indexes and things like that. We would store that observable in this graph, but we wouldn't actually store it in the database because we're able to regenerate it. But for performance reasons, it's much nicer if you don't have to. It's in memory and so on. So, yeah. Does that Nope? Cool. So yeah, as I say, in our production environment, about 1,000 subscriptions for the average client, and you know, these usually have thousands of these little observables in practice because there's tons of things on the page. And then a typical server has in the ballpark of 100,000 observables in memory at a given time. So I mean, this is a huge graph. And then we have tons of servers too. So it's important to also note that some of these observables are duplicated across there, and you have to figure out, like, hey, when do we swap them out? And it's really, it's a cache problem. But clearly, if the client is connected and listening to it, then they're going to keep it in memory, usually. So anyway, does this make sense? We propagate these along? Cool. I'm going to go really high level through kind of our database, because I think it kind of helps to explain some of how we're able to do all this. We have a fully distributed database that's built on top of Redis. The thing is really, really fast. And it replicates across data centers. And it has point-in-time recovery, too, which is a really important feature. If something goes wrong, you can go back to any particular snapshot along the way and see what happened. It's transactional, so sometimes people say transactional, they just mean that you can do transactions against a particular table. Now, you can read, write, do all kinds of crazy things in transactions, and then ultimately roll it back or commit it, and that will all work. So, and a part of the reason for that is that we do a lot of these things edit-based, and we try to minimize conflicts as much as possible, but every once in a while you're still going to have them, and you just need to roll back the transactions. Two people both decide that they want to have the same unique username, and you're like, well, that's not going to happen. So one of them has to get rolled back if they both want it to do exactly the same time. That just prevents, you know, problems. Is anybody you're familiar with like a relational database, it's the same thing. And then the edit base is nice too, because if two people join the same community at the same time, you don't want to have a conflict there. You want to push that edit and that edit, and then if you ultimately decide both of those commit, you have both those edits in there, and you didn't have to compute the whole intermediate value to push that forward. So it's much, yeah.
So say, is your sharding designed around the premise that those type of conflicts would happen inside the same database server, or is this conflict resolution actually span multiple logical machines?
It spans multiple logical machines. So it is truly transactional and distributed and has failover. Yeah.
Is that all homegrown, or?
Yes. Okay. Yes, it is. Yeah, and then the basic stuff you'd expect to see out of any good relational database. We have unique indexes, partial indexes. I don't know if MySQL has these yet, but I don't really consider MySQL to be production ready, so, you know. but Postgres does, it has for many years. It's strongly typed, once again. If you want to be efficient with memory, like you really want to be strongly typed so that you can have efficient binary serialization formats. If you're storing things in JSON, there's a lot of downsides to that. You can have indexes on, where you use both hashing and ordering. So like a traditional database like, you know, Postgres or whatever, unless you have a hash index, it's not quite actually production ready, but you can use them. Clearly in a highly distributed system, you have to be able to have a hash index. You can't just use B-trees for everything. What we do is we allow you to hash on any number of fields and then order on any number of fields as well at the actual key itself. So that gives us a ton of flexibility, which we need, because a lot of times we have huge sets of data, and we need to be able to efficiently say, okay, I want to run this particular query, and I need these things ordered already in this particular way, or I need to see if these two things intersect, and because we have a lot of data, it's graph data, it has to be able to do all that stuff. And then, of course, we have a lot of things where it's like, we index arrays as well. So if you have an array type in your table, you can index on all the things in there. So if you guys are ever familiar with, like if you search for a person's name or something like that, what we would actually do is we would break that name down into different trigrams and then index on each of those trigrams, and you can reassemble a person's name. It lets you do partial name searches, things like that. So all that stuff we have. There's more, but that's kind of the highly important pieces.
Is there a unified query mechanism, or do you guys just like a cabal of Lua scripts and JavaScript and stuff that makes all this run?
We have a way to specify a query plan. And we are in the process of building a query parser that actually can create a query plan. So if you understand how like a relational database works, it defines from the query, it parses the query, and then it picks a few different possible query plans and then decides which one's best based on its estimates, and then it goes with that query. So in our particular case, we don't have that those first couple steps, but if you do get a query by just say, hey, use this index, use this index, use this index, it will be able to use that to generate that. And that's all been metadata driven, which is super nice, because it'll build all the observables for you and make sure that they're namespaced and don't collide and that sort of thing as well. So, does that make sense? Yeah. So, this is simplified, because I didn't want to make you guys read through too much code. I don't know, can you read that? Can some of you read that?
I guess it's been so far back here.
It's a little squinty.
A little squinty? Okay. So I'll just walk you through kind of the big stuff here. Basically what we do is when we open up a transaction, at some point we decide, you know, hey, I want to try and commit it. Or you roll it back. But if you decide to commit it, it's going to look in it and say, okay, when did I start? And I there's some kind of window that a transaction has to commit. And there's reasons for that, which we don't need to get into. But ours is set to a certain time that it has to basically do as many fetches and business logic checks as it wants. If it meets that commit deadline, and we have a, I don't want to get into that. If it meets the commit deadline, it can commit, in which case it's going to take and pretty much say, okay, what are all the edits I've done, which have already been written out to individual shards, but tagged with the transaction ID that it belongs to. If I commit, I now write out and say to multiple nodes, hey, I've committed this transaction, so now in the future, when something goes to look on those individual nodes, it's going to see, okay, that particular edit with transaction ID 152, that one, that transaction, it either committed, it rolled back, or it's pending. And if it committed, then I use that edit and I apply that edit to the value. If it rolled back, I ignore it. And if it's pending, I can ignore it, except if it's a potential conflict, in which case it was a potential conflict, then I need to either wait for that transaction or fail. Which is, this is the same mechanism that any good database that has multi-version concurrency control uses. So we use the same pattern. When we commit it, we write that. That's what this line right here is doing, is it's sending off that information to the local array. And then we basically, you know, say, okay, after a certain amount of time, we are going to call our transaction resolve callbacks, and we keep following this down. We broadcast that that transaction has committed, and finally, once we get this return here, this tells us, hey, we've also written it to our point-in-time recovery log on S3. And if we crash in the middle here, we have enough local data to actually recover and detect that we didn't sync that out to S3 and send it out when we start that instance again. So the only way we really lose data is if the whole data center like goes down. And if that happens and you lose a couple seconds of data, probably no one's going to fire you over it. So, yeah.
It's super interesting. And sorry, this is kind of like a basic question, but how do you share observables or variables between servers without having them written to a database that they're all servers are connected to?
Yes, and actually the next thing I was going to talk about, I can go back to this slide to show you at a high level, and then I'll go to the next slide, which shows you some of the, come on.
Because it's kind of interesting, it's like you've got this in-memory situation.
Yes.
And then you've got a commit.
Yeah.
That is after that.
Absolutely. So when somebody likes something, and it runs through all the business logic and decides to commit, at that point, it's going to forward along that edit to the other servers that need to see that edit. And instead of sending the whole value, it incrementally sends whatever the edit is that it made. So for instance, if this observable is, hey, how many people like the post that we looked at earlier that Perrin commented on? And that's this observable, and that's the one that somebody likes. We're going to send a little edit along that says, hey, plus one to that observable right there. And then this one's going to get that in, and it's going to apply it. It's off, yeah.
But how does it know which server to send it to?
Yeah, that's complicated.
Okay.
Is it a broker topology, or is it just a talk?
I'd rather not get into that.
Okay, all right.
I will, however, show you the updating server cache code. So similar to how we have that on message on the client, where you know we receive edits. Servers themselves also receive that packet like we just were talking about. And this is the code that basically reads in that packet and parses it. So it reads in and says, okay, what was the transaction ID, what was the commit time, and then the rest of the packet, which contains a bunch of information about which observables were changed in that transaction and so on. And then it applies that, and I don't want to get into all that, but basically it then goes in and finds those observables and applies those edits to them that it has. And if it occasionally sends along data that it doesn't need to, it doesn't break anything. So that's basically my presentation. You guys didn't ask as many questions as I expected, so. Yeah.
Can you go back to the commit slide, the one you have?
Yeah.
Is the max time to commit transaction, is that a magic number or what?
Right, so this particular constant, let's see if I can remember this now. It's a while ago when I wrote this code. That one is the amount of time in the worst case that it would take for it to get out to the various instances, the various Redis instances, and either successfully connect to them or fail.
So it's just an approximation at this point?
It's not an approximation. You pick a number here that you're guaranteed is going to be high enough. And it sounds like voodoo, but it isn't voodoo. You really don't have a case where that's going to fail. The only time that's going to fail is if you have like multiple hardware failures. And at the point where you have multiple hardware failures, you just shut down the data center anyway. So on our particular topology, it's way under 1 millisecond for it to reach one of the Redis servers and get a round trip acknowledgement. So this, I don't remember what we have it set at, but whatever we have it set at, it's never ever going to be in sufficient time. Yeah.
How do you ensure that your graphs are acyclic? I mean, obviously, sure. Like you guys have a very large amount of in-memory graphs.
Right. Well, they're not random, I think is the first thing to keep in mind. I mean, there's a very clear hierarchy to a lot of this stuff. So if you think about it, like, say we have a feed that's, hey, what's popular, which we have, you know, a popular feed for various things. That pulls from very specific places. Those places that it pulls from would have no reason to pull from the popular feed to find out that same information, because one of them is clearly derived from the other. If you were just randomly making observables, you might theoretically make a cycle, but we don't randomly make them. I mean, these are all prescribed by metadata that defines, hey, I depend on this. So we would even be able to detect at compile time itself if you were even writing code that could lead to a cycle.
So you don't have users yet that are producing keys?
No.
Okay.
We define what all the different key spaces are and how given a key, what that means, and then how that meaning gets translated.
Yeah. On that same point, this is kind of a bunch of questions at once, so I'll try to keep it straight. But when I was working with the Flapjack stuff back a few years ago, and one of the ways they solved it was with a topological sort, which basically, mm-hmm. in practice, meant there was an integer that was being incremented every time a node was being created that might be attached to some graph. And so what happened is when you would attach it to the graph, the attachment process would actually walk the whole graph, mm-hmm. and then if it ended up seeing the number where it started, it says, you know, pow, and it blows right. up and won't work. So you don't.
Yeah, that would be a disaster in our environment because we have, you know, so many. I mean, I don't actually even know the exact number, but I mean, let's put it this way: it's so many millions. It's not single digit millions. I don't have to think about even what it is, but it's an insane number of observables we would have if it had to actually walk that tree. It would be completely unusable. So I guess what I would say is, at a high level, we try to convert dynamic computations to static computations as much as possible.
Sure.
That's why we use strong typing. That's why we're declarative on all these things to begin with. We can verify that you're not going to have a case of the dependencies being that way at compile time when you parse out those schemas.
Well, I was going to say is that so when you're talking about like a deployed version of Locker Dome. Does that mean in toto like the pages that are going to render based on those graphs, the what's happening in the servers is basically been frozen down from a compile step from end to end, and then it's kind of like version that whole graph is versioned. Or are the graphs fully dynamic and they?
The graphs are completely dynamic, but the categories in them are not. So, for instance, we have a concept of, hey, you can like something, you can comment, you can hang, you can reply, you can post these various things. And we have actually a whole set of types. And then each of those types has defined, hey, these are the indexes on it. And then from there we have searches, as we call them internally. But basically searches are, okay, so given this particular, these indexes, this is how you pull data from them and compute our search. And sometimes those things have code in them, but they work best if they're purely metadata and just have query plans. And then those searches can in turn depend on other searches and so on. But we're able to determine that there's not really any cycles. There's a couple places you could write one, but the number of places you even have to look to see if that's there would be so low anyway. And it's not a pattern anyone would actually write, because it doesn't actually have any meaning in the real world. I mean, if you think about like what's it mean for there to be a cycle, it means that somehow you have a dependency on something that has a dependency back on yourself, which doesn't even make any sense from any kind of actual logic. It's more of a mathematical thing or like something computer scientists would deal with, but in an actual practical application, it's not going to be an issue.
Let's see, in practical terms, kind of what you're saying is that part of the graph is effectively pre-computed. I mean, in other words, you've kind of laid out this kind of skeleton that's not going to change. Like everything is going to flow.
The categories will not. So I'll give you a basic example. So everything in our system that's an entity or an action has an ID associated with it. And we have a way of scoping those where when you convert those IDs, the IDs themselves can take at most 53 bits because of how JavaScript works. So we have three wasted bits, and then we scope it under a specific bytecode that now if we then look at that key, we can translate and say, okay, well, the first bytecode says we have an entity, and then we look at this ID, and actually from that ID, we can actually deduce the type of the entity that it is. And that key right there, well, that can't possibly depend on anything. I mean, because it is itself is primary data in the database.
Right.
Yeah.
So when you say strongly typed, is that because you're checking a chunk of the key for a certain type code?
No, that's part of it. That allows us to know how to deserialize what we have stored in the database. But we actually have schemas for all these things too. So for instance, if we had a type that was like a point and had an x and a y and they're an integer, and you're saying, okay, each of these are int fours, then like they each take 4 bytes, then our serialization format would be, hey, grab the first 4 bytes and that's x, and the second 4 bytes and that's y. And when we deserialize it, we would basically have 8 bytes we would have stored in Redis for that.
So you gave the example of a page where you have votes and then percentages of the votes. And so if you call that like one level deep as far as dependencies go, it seems to me that most things on the page would be zero deep. You have a large number of observables, but it doesn't seem that it would be common that many things on the page would depend on other things on the page. Are there examples where it goes like 3 or 4 deep?
Four deep is definitely, well, no. So no, here's what I'd say to that. There are actually a lot of those examples. So if you imagine you have a feed, the most basic observable that you'd be syncing to the server would be, hey, what's in this feed? So if I have a feed of your activity on Locker Dome, anytime you do something, that needs to change. So I have a feed of that, and then in a particular slot, I'm gonna have, okay, well, this feed ID with this activity ID, which now take those and feed this into this other model, which now is going to do some kind of fetch from the back end. That's just because it's an asynchronous step doesn't mean it's not a dependency that's connected in your observable tree on the front. And then that might say, okay, we'll go fetch this piece of content, and then that piece of content had who authored it, which is another fetch, which is another one deep. And now I need to know, okay, well, what's the person's name on that? And say I want to know, okay, well, what networks or what communities do we have in common? I mean, you start getting it, you can have these be really deep where any one little thing could change and the whole thing would update.
How often do those observables write themselves out to Redis? Like if you have an update?
The intermediate ones, we don't ever write to Redis.
So everything that's in the middle layer is in-memory intermediate building up and then from Redis,
Yes.
And then whatever observables that happen to be touching Redis are the ones that actually write to Redis.
Yes. The two types that are written up here are the primary entity values, which are just have a primary key of their ID, basically, and then indexes. And everything else is considered computed and is only going to live in here and here. Because those are all able to be generated from the others.
This is probably a dumb question again. So, from what I see, Locker Room, it's not a single page app, right? So you go to a port, cast a word, you go to a quiz, whatnot. So the observables are gone because you go to another page, right?
Right.
So what if hypothetically you wanted to build a single page app wherein you want to have these sessions maintained? Do you think that can be possible with this model? Because you're going to have tons and tons of observables because you don't know what workflow you are in at that time. So
I would actually argue that the way that our page is structured, if you change the URL, we would, with very little work, be able to, without even doing another page reload, we would actually be able to update everything on the page to sync it to that new URL. And actually, you guys can tell me if I'm wrong on this, but I think the router already has, or is pretty darn close to having enough information to do that.
Right, but I see.
Is that right?
Yeah, the one thing we're not doing that right now on the main pages is just because we have to implement the cache validation on the front.
Yeah, but I'm talking more from an
observable. Get rid of the observables, because right now they're just kind of growing.
Right. So can you manage that many of observables in that case? Because you could.
You don't need to, because you can flush out the ones that you're not using.
Right.
Okay. So if you update the page so that you're now only showing certain things, and this gets back to I think what you were talking about, but that's even a more specialized case. So that case is really simple. You could just look at it and say nothing's referring to this observable, we'll flush it. There's also a case of nothing can see it, which is like another kind of gray area.
That's what I'm getting.
But if nothing can see it isn't what you need, because if nothing can see it, there's a category of we're not even rendering that particular page, you might say, inside our single page app. Like we just clicked to a new thing and we refreshed the whole page. Now we're not showing that feed anymore. We know that we're not showing that feed anymore. So we could push all those observables out of memory and just sync them through the website. Absolutely could do that. No problem at all. But you, at that point, definitely want to make sure you don't have any leaks. Because if you kept clicking, you could have issues.
Go ahead. I guess I'm a little confused about the keys. From what you said before, but basically, my question is, if you have a upvote for a topic X,
mm-hmm.
can you walk us through what a simple cycle of your client side to Redis would be?
Sure.
So what that would mean?
So yeah, so this is like a like. So what we would do with this is first thing we would do is we would say, okay, you want to create a like. This is the target. This is the creator. It's you. If you are liking something, the target is whatever you're liking. And then we'd say, okay, well, that one has a unique index that you can only like it once, right? Which makes sense. You can't like the same thing multiple times. So we would have a business rule that automatically would check, because we have a unique index on that, we would check in the back end and see, hey, has this person already liked this? And we would write to that key then in that same step and say, I'm at this transaction and I want to create a like that has this ID and has this particular combination of liker and the target that's being liked. I don't know if I'm committing yet, so I'm just going to write that edit with my transaction ID to that key. So that if you try to do it twice at the same time, one of them would fail. And so you do that, and then you write to any other indexes as well that would be updated, hey, what's the like count on that particular piece of thing you're liking? What's my activity index of the things that I've liked and so on? And make all those edits. Then I say, okay, did I run any conflicts? No. Did all my business logic pass? Yes. Okay, I'm going to go ahead and try and commit. And then that still can fail, but if it doesn't fail, now we've committed that transaction. At that point, now I'm going to forward along that edit to the local observables and to any other observables, and I'm going to write to the transaction specific transaction ID and say, this transaction committed, and I'm going to put a local thing in the data center to say, hey, this needs to be pushed off to S3, and then I'm also going to try to do it, and then if I crash in the meantime, when it boots back up, it'll see that that transaction still needs to be sent off to S3.
How did you know what observables to put on the client? Clearly, you don't put the entire memory model, all the observables on the client. You don't create 10,000 observables on the client side. How do you know which observables to create in order to facilitate the UI?
So that's just driven by, it's driven by this, basically, and then if we go a step back, maybe you can see where these, I didn't show it, but this can be connected somehow. We actually have a syntax that says, hey, I depend upon this ID, and there's a way to define it so that it's like, okay, so I take the input from here, and I want to fetch this entity, and I want these specific fields from it. One of them could be, hey, what's the like count on it, and I'm going to subscribe to that.
But how do you differentiate between the observable that pertains to server operations versus the observable that pertains to client operations?
Well, they're just in different tiers completely.
Oh, okay, so they are completely in different tiers.
Yeah, I mean, they will stay in sync, but it's up to the server to push along in that tree. For instance, these observables are the same, basically the same value, though this one's very slightly delayed. So when this one updates, it just pushes along to the client-side version. But this represents that same value. Yeah.
So did you write your own client-side framework? And if so, why couldn't you just use Angular or Ember?
That's a good question. The decision was made. I think you could make an argument either way. I think one of the things that I would say is I definitely have an appreciation for using existing libraries. With that said, I do believe there were certain things about Angular and Ember that I did not like. It's a trade-off. My general advice to startups would be leverage everything you possibly can.
I guess the other question, I could ask the same thing about your database, right? Was there really no database that had the features you wanted?
There is not a database that has those features.
Would you sell this one up?
No. No, but if you want to come work at Lagerdome, then you can find it.
On the same tip, could you describe the stack and why you chose JavaScript on the back end for certain things and what the Sock.js also maybe, and where JavaScript doesn't work for you?
The weaknesses of JavaScript in my mind is it is a hacky language. I will admit that. It doesn't perform as well as C++, obviously. The fact that it's weakly typed has some very serious drawbacks. One of them being the one I alluded to earlier, you cannot have a 64-bit integer. That is insane. It's an incredible weakness for a language, particularly one that you ever want to write performing code with. So that's one we've had to work around. As far as the reasons why we picked it, we picked it because we were already going to have a front end using JavaScript. We had a team of people that knew it, and it is still relatively fast as far as languages go, and frankly, every programmer should know it. Also, V8 works with C++ pretty well, and Node has a huge ecosystem around it. So. I think that you can make arguments for all sorts of languages. If I had to do again, I would have given a serious thought to a pure functional language like Haskell. But, JavaScript has done well for us.
Would you say, though, that the lack of 64-bit integers is an issue when you're writing a framework like you were doing, but for kind of a general application, that limitation doesn't normally come up?
Yeah, I still think it's a weakness. I mean, I don't want to get into saying exactly that, different people have different preferences on languages. From my standpoint, strongly typed is good if you can do it because it reduces the number of errors you can write. That's my style, so from my standpoint, it's a plus. To be able to define a type and have it enforce a type is good. To not have to use doubles to represent 53-bit integers, I think this pretty image everyone can agree would be nice. There's a lot of reasons why doubles just kind of suck to represent integers.
So with using SockJS, what is the lowest version of IE that you're able to support?
It actually, believe it or not, supports IE6.
Wow.
Yeah. I can't argue that it would be performant in IE6, but then what is? So, and if you're supporting IE6, you probably work in the government. There was somebody.
Do you actually run all your tests on IE6?
No, we do not support IE6. We don't actually officially support IE8, to be honest. Yeah, what's up?
So, like, all of your data is in physical RAM, right?
Yes. Well, and it's backed up to S3 as well.
Okay.
Yeah, and we use point-in-time recovery, so it's like streaming the every single transaction that gets committed.
Okay, cool. So like a computer, if like one computer in a data center crashes?
Well, if one crashes, it's fine, because we have two copies. But if for whatever reason both copies crash, at that point you probably just are like, yeah, we're not having a good day as a data center, just go down. And then we have anycast IPs that would, within about 30 seconds, they would just route the traffic to the next nearest data center. We don't use that DNS thing because it's a hack. Don't let them sell you on that. It's just a great way for them to make tons of money. But with anycast IPs, basically, they all are like, hey, my name's Bob. And like so-and-so says, I'm Bob too. And then whichever one's closest to you, you're going to hear that person saying, I'm Bob. And if that person dies, then you're like, OK, well, the next closest person is who I'll go to. So anycast IPs are great. Highly recommend them.
How much physical RAM do you have?
Like, I can't talk about that.
Terabytes.
we don't store all the actual images themselves there. Those are stored on S3 and then have a CDN. So metadata and the graph data, if you're storing it in binary, I just say it's not as big as people think. Yeah, it's actually like if you start using not JSON for everything, you can actually pack a lot of data in a pretty small amount of space.
Did you actually roll your own binary format, or did you?
Yeah, so it takes the schemas, and then it generates a binary format and actually puts a small version code at the beginning so that we can migrate in the future. Yeah. But yeah, we don't like write custom functions for each one. It uses the schemas to build the binary format, the serialized and initialized functions, yeah.
Does that same binary format serve the wire as well as the storage, or
it serves the stuff from server to server, but it does not go to the front end because certain browsers do not do real well with the Cool. I exhausted all your questions.
So when's your functional reactive framework going to open source?
I don't know. Yeah, there's a lot to in order to get something, ready for the public.
Nice.
So it's not our primary function as a business, but I can tell you I would love for it to be public.
Is there a functional reactive library that you recommend, maybe for someone that doesn't have all the needs that your project does, but just a basic library for that?
I think looking for an ecosystem is a really important thing. Angular has a lot of momentum around it. I think it's a solid framework. It's not going to do all of that, but it's a pretty solid framework.
I like it a lot, but I was actually talking about not something so UI focused, but more just a framework of having observables and listeners in JavaScript.
I don't think you need a framework for that piece. If you're, let me go back to this code. I mean, this is like, this is almost nothing. Oops, where is it? Hold on. There we go. This is almost nothing, right? I mean, you can make a more complicated one, but just making observables and passing along things like that, it's not actually that hard. The part that makes a lot of this hard is when you start having to distribute it and you start needing to make it performant. Those are the things that are going to quickly make it complicated.
I think that comes close to this as Meteor, probably, right?
Yeah.
Okay. The client to server synchronization.
Yeah.
And do you do any kind of dirty checking with this pattern?
Yeah, we actually do. I just didn't want to have the coding for that. It's, yeah, you want to, yeah, I mean, let's see here. I can show that. It's a good question. I'll show you something really quick. They'll give a good explanation as to why. So particularly if this is not synchronously updated, this one right here depends on this through two different paths. It's like there's like a diamond, you might say. So if you naively iterate through an update and then eagerly propagate, you're going to update this one and then you're going to on the next iteration through this loop, you're going to update this one, and you're going to end up updating that one again, which then means that anything downstream of this is going to be updated multiple times, and it could grow way out of control. So you do want to do some form of scheduling. Once again, if performance matters, you do want to do that. And if you can have those kinds, which some people don't have that issue. Did you have a question?
I was going to ask kind of a similar question, leading towards, and I was going to ask what you thought about Meteor JS, because it's kind of similar, like it uses handlebars for the templating.
Yeah.
I mean, from what I've heard good things, but I personally haven't used it. When we started working on this, it was definitely not production ready from everybody that I had talked to. And I'd tell you, I'd rather not use an in-progress framework by somebody else. That seems like a bad idea. Yeah.
Take one more pass at an earlier question, but this slide will help. So when you're at this boundary here, so you've hit the client, mm-hmm. and you're propagating through this graph, is from here to all the endpoints it'll reach, is that synchronous? Or could any one of these hops also be an asynchronous boundary?
They could be asynchronous boundaries because what could happen, for instance, so say this one is represented by, hey, take this ID and go fetch, say you have one that's like, hey, I need to feed in this ID and something else, and then do some kind of fetch against the backend, and I'm actually going to then subscribe to that. Well, what would happen is, say that ID changes, then it might change what you need to fetch from the backend. So then it ends up becoming an asynchronous step.
Sure. Well, the reason I ask is because then that begs the question of, like, what happens if you get another signal? And
exactly.
Here, in the meantime, do you hold it and wait until
right. That
guy's finished, or what's your pattern?
Right. So we're still working through that, and I would argue there is no perfect general solution. I would definitely argue that. But
you can just pick. You've yeah. only got two choices.
The one we're moving towards, with a couple exceptions, the default is going to be to wait for the whole thing to resolve. But there are cases where that's a downside. For our particular case, it's not so bad because we generally have a pretty darn fast connection to the back end. But there's downsides there.
You're basically creating a blocking queue,
right?
Which is tricky in the language that does it.
Well, and also because unless you're passing version information along with these, then you don't actually have a good way of knowing, like, hey, did this one get updated? Did this one get updated? Should we group those together? And I mean, the truth is, we don't handle that situation perfectly. I think with time we'll handle it better, but it's a very difficult problem. There's not any perfect way to handle it in all cases.
That's where Sorag reports, the communicating sequential processes, has some good information on that. And he developed a whole theory about how to deal with that. So.
Well, I'll make one of these guys read it.
It's a course, CSPs, communicating sequential processes.
Well, I'll go to my last little slide.
If anybody is interested in looking at like an open source reactive framework, there's an old one that started way back in 2006, which is pretty mind-blowing if you think about it, because that was even before the JavaScript Renaissance. But it's called Flapjacks, FLAPJAX. It was a grad student project at Brown University, and it's still sort of actively maintained even until the present day. The commits have slowed way down since 2009. But it is maintained. And you can see the history and see how it evolved. The other one that's open source is Microsoft's Reactive Extensions, or just RxJS, specifically for the JavaScript one. That's also open source. So if you want to see the guts of how something like this works, check it out. Although, you're
right. Or come work at Lockerdome, like I said,
the observer pattern isn't that complicated. So you can begin to grow it up yourself if you just want to try and chain and raise the listeners.
It's crazy.
So that'll work out.
Wow. If you're crazy, like us.
BaconJS, another.
BaconJS would be another open source one, so similar heritage, you might say, or whatever, lineage.
Yeah, no, that's all I got. Thanks for being a good audience.